be there. And or the biggest factor, however, though, is the expense. So the reels that we're talking about are expensive. It's not like the, you know, the memory card or any of the digital media, which is cheap today or cost effective, right? So what used to happen is the producers used to be limited by the number of screens in which the movie can be released on a week. So they used to, they could probably afford about 10 such prints, right? We used to have what is called the DI master. And then, so 10 such prints could be made, which means really that you can release the movie only in 10 screens or 10 theaters, right? And there used to be a concept of first run and then the other runs. The first run is the 10 screens where it will actually be, the movie would be released. That's where, that those are the days where you used to have a 100-day run, right? So if a movie plays for 100 days, then it's a super hit movie. But today you don't talk about 100 days. It's the first weekend collection that we really talk about. And how is it enabled? Because of moving to digital or the lack of such facility with the film reels. And the other big limitation with that was, again, storage, inventory cost. We're really talking about big reels. And how are we actually going to store all this content after the movie is done? The producer is not going to just throw away his creative work. So the studio or the production house needs to store all this somewhere, which again incurs cost. And the projectors, I've seen one projector which uses the film reels. It's as big as a pillar. So that pillar that you actually see, right? So which means that every screen needs to have that much size in a projector room for you to be able to play that. And they're noisy as well because you're actually physically moving the reels over through the projector for you to actually enable playback. So, and the other biggest limitation was those no security. Once they hand over the reel to the theater, they can actually physically move the reel somewhere else, play it in another theater. There's no restriction on you know, who gets to see the content or you know, so the concept of piracy was very, very prevalent at that point, right? So these were the main limitations of the film reels and why the industry wanted to move towards digital cinema.
Yeah, so I'm going to explain how digital cinema solves all those problems. But before we get into that, let's talk about history. I mean, how the whole transition happened. What is digital cinema is and how it is able to solve all this problem. So digital cinema around the world started in year 2002. Major studios like Disney, Universal, Warner Brothers, and there are a couple of other studios who joined together and they formed this body called DCI, Digital Cinema Initiative. The objective behind that body is to come up with a specification of open architecture where there is a uniform quality of technical performance as well as interoperability between the digital cinema system. So they set out to work coming up with this spec, and it took 3 years for them to release the very first version of digital cinema specification. By the time there were interim specification by ad hoc groups that used some codecs like MPEG in digital cinema. But the very first version came in 2005, and the last version, or the latest version that we have is 1.3, which was released in 2015. But the industry did not adopt it quickly. It took nearly, I mean, more than 10 years for them to completely transition. For various reasons, you know, they have invested in projector, they have invested in film rolls, and the entire workflow, the chain, everything is relied on the analog cinema. And they really need to see the value in digital, and then only they move. So slowly, we in India, Qube brought digital cinema to Indian cinema market. There were times where Bollywood movie makers travel to Chennai and they create digital cinema. They play it across India. So, but it happened. The transition really happened, even though it took nearly 10 years. So today, almost all cinema in the world runs on digital cinema. But there are screens, like Dhanya mentioned, there are directors who still are so passionate about that texture of the film that they want to run, they want to take movies in film roles and they want to play movies in film roles. So, but apart from that, the 180,000 screens around the world uses a digital cinema. So what is digital cinema? I mean, what exactly a digital cinema? What is the technical specification of it? So the digital cinema is nothing but a J2K encoded video with a resolution of 2K or 4K, which is like 2048x1080 and 4096x2160. And it is 24 FPS generally. And the audio is a raw PCM or a WAV format. And each movie weighs around between 200 to 300 GB. That's digital cinema for you. The audio, video are individual files. And we have some XML files that are digitally signed that carries information, metadata about these files, how to play them, and what are the sensor cuts, and how many channels are there. So yeah, that's about the content. So the content is actually called DCP, Digital Cinema Package. And this content is getting exchanged between various systems within digital cinema. And security is highest importance in digital cinema. I mean, we know movies are made in multi-million dollar budget. So the systems within the digital cinema ecosystem talks through a secure channel, usually TLS. But there are other ways of doing communication in a secure manner. Yeah, so the content is fully encrypted. It is encrypted with the AES-128-bit key, and that key is wrapped with the RSA-2048 key, and this key is always exchanged in the form of in wrapped form. So it is not easy. Even if you have the content, you really cannot play the content. In fact, in the physical delivery, which will Dhanya explain in detail, we usually send the content through couriers, so anybody can access it, but they cannot make use of it. So what are all the benefits of digital cinema? I mean, so Dhanya mentioned the problems with the analog cinema, how those are all solved, and does it bring any other additional benefit in movie watching experience? So the first and foremost is the better experience. We are not limited with just 24 frames per second. That was the predominantly frame rate in analog cinema. Now we have variety of frame rate. So there is a more creative freedom for the directors. For example, one popular example is Hobbit. How many of you watched a Hobbit movie? So do you know that movie is a 48 FPS 3D? And that means that each eye sees 48 frames. So totally, there are 96 frames per second. And the next Avatar is, we heard it is taken in more than 100 FPS. So it's not sure, but it is in progress. So that is the kind of artistic freedom digital cinema gives us. And majority of this enhancement doesn't require any hardware change. It is mostly involves a firmware level change or a software level change. The next big advantage is the easier distribution. So like I said, it's around 300 GB. You can ship it through courier, you can download it. There are different ways of delivering this content to theater, and you don't have to worry about someone pirating from the source because it is fully encrypted. So yeah, that's And I talked about the different delivery modes. So the final thing is, there is a common misconception that many people I speak, they say that, oh, you are streaming the movie. No, we are not. So digital cinema is never a streamed format, because there are multiple reasons. The primary reason is we are not ready, or the industry is not ready to compromise on the quality. So it is a J2K encoding, but each frame is encoded separately. There is no inter-frame compression. This gives a better quality as well as better freedom or operational freedom when we cut the movie for sensors and other purposes. So because of this higher quality, higher resolution, we end up having 300 GB, and you cannot really stream 300 GB over internet, commodity internet. So you need at least 250 Mbps. And even if you have a 250 Mbps, imagine yourself sitting in a theater and suddenly there is this buffering icon appearing on the screen. Would you tolerate that? No, right? So that is why it is always a store and play model. Content is either sent through hard disk or downloaded internet before the show. But once the show starts, there is no stop. I mean, there shouldn't be any interruption in it. We use satellite delivery, but again, there it is not. It is a broadcast, but it is not a stream. The content is broadcast, but it is stored, then played. So those are all the benefits of digital cinema. I'll hand over to Dhanya to talk about the workflow of digital cinema.
Okay. So briefly, I touched upon the way technology is involved in bringing the content from the producer to the to the audience, right? So there are a lot of things that actually goes on in between. Once the creative content is ready, the first step is the production house needs to package the content in a way that it can be played in any theater or any screen in the world, right? So just like the how you have an MP3 format in which, which can be played in any player. So there are servers, digital cinema servers manufactured by different manufacturers. The content should be playable. So the forum that Shiva was talking about, the DCI forum, has come up with the standard format, similar to what MP3 is for music. For digital cinema, we have what is called a digital cinema package, or it's a DCP, right? So the content needs to be packaged in that format. And in addition to actually doing that, you also have, there are a few things that happen in this step, right? One is the color correction. So when the creators come up with the content, finally how it appears on the screen as opposed to what they see in the editing room or in their cameras, there might be a slight difference. So the color correction happens after, when the DCP is created. And the size of the digital content also is encoded so that the size is reduced and it can be easily transported and ingested in the servers, right? And a couple of other things that happens is, one is for encryption for piracy. So this is the place where content is encrypted. So the moment content is encrypted, even if any of us get access to that particular content, it's as good as a paperweight, right? We really can't do anything with it unless we have the server for which the production has actually issued a key to unlock and play the content. And that's very, very critical. So until that step is actually done, nobody can access the content other than the production and the people who are working on it. Even the people who are working on the DCP, nobody gets to see more than 2 minutes of the content, because the storyline will actually leak out, right? And another thing, once the DCP is ready, it needs to be quality checked. So what happens is, so all this happens in the first stage of digital cinema content readiness, which is mastering, right? So the DCP is made available, And then there is a team who actually sees the entire movie multiple times just to see if there's any flicker or if the color is actually, you know, what the creator actually intended to for the audience to actually see. Right? There could be a small, you know, change in the shade of green or a gray, which, I mean, I can't tell, but I'm sure, you know, we've heard cases where the creators have actually been picky. This is not the shade of the red that I actually wanted. What is coming out is actually different. So there's a lot of back and forth that happens. And so, yeah, the first step is mastering where the content is ready. Now, next, once the content is ready, the next step is that it has to reach the theaters where the content needs to be played. And that phase is called the distribution, right? I'm not going to touch too much on distribution in this slide because that's what we're going to talk about in the remaining part of the session. And the final part is exhibition, right? When I talk about exhibition, it's pretty much what happens in the theater. So when we think of exhibition, again, there are two sides to the coin, right? One is the consumer-facing side, which we're all familiar with. Booking tickets, going to the theater, you know, what are the concessions that are available, the experience, how you book your concession, how you watch the movie without any interruption, and how you come out. But before all that, there's a lot that goes on in the background, right? So one, there's a server that is ready and available, which needs to play the content. And the content that is sent to the theater needs to be ingested or loaded into the server. And then the key that I spoke about to unlock the content needs to be made available for that server. So the match between the content and the key needs to happen. And all this needs to happen before the show is ready or before the audience walks in, right? And then the shows need to be scheduled for each screen so that, you know, the audience can go book the theater, the tickets itself. And there's a whole lot of scheduling and planning that happens in each theater in terms of which movie has to be screened in which screen at what time, depending on the demand, time of the day, and what movie it is. Right? And then the ads. So we see ads before the movie and in between the movie, right? So there is a lot of thought process that goes on, you know, before even scheduling the ads in terms of when to actually schedule the ad and what ad needs to play when, in which screen, depending on the demographic of people who are coming there, depending on, you know, what movie we are playing. Say if it's a children movie, what are the kind of ads that we need to play? So this technology that enables all that. And then once the ads are available, then scheduling the ads and getting the content for the ads available in that particular server. So all these happen on the B2B part of the exhibition network. And yeah, so this whole ecosystem is came into being because of digital cinema. Right? Okay, so now we'll talk about what distribution is. So any idea how distribution works today, movie distribution? From whatever you're aware of in, from the papers, tabloids. Okay. Okay. Yeah, cool. And that's the production and the distributor. How about the other end of the ecosystem? Distributor to the theater. Okay. Okay. Cool. Yeah, fairly good representation. So what happens is the production house, one, they can choose to distribute the movie themselves if they're familiar with, you know, the different markets and, you know, to which theater they need to play the content in, where it will go and all that. But oftentimes what happens is the producers sell the rights for, you know, to rights for exhibition to the distributors. So, and then the distributors then work out a deal with the theaters to see, you know, where all they can actually play the content. It could be because, you know, the distributors, and we'll talk about the regional distributors as well, wherein for each market, you'll have a distributor. For Indian cinema, like Ramki mentioned, there might be, you know, for South, there might be one distributor, and for North, there might be one distributor. Or again, based on the distribution, these distribution territories are not the political or the geographical territories, right? They are separate distribution territories based on the borders, you know, where one theater from Bangalore or, you know, from Karnataka might still fall under a Tamil Nadu distribution territory. That's just an example. I don't know if this example is right, but yeah. And so we have the distributor and the rights flow that way. And between, so the distributors would know what kind of, you know, what are the theaters where a specific movie is likely to, you know, fetch more revenue in. So they'll work out a deal with the theaters. And so what typically happens, okay, so this was a learning for me before I started working in digital cinema. So until that point, I used to think that the distributors rent the screens to play their content, or, you know, for their content to play. But actually the business works the other way around, right? So wherein it's the theater guys or the exhibitors who rent the content from the distributor to enable playback in their screens, right? And there's a revenue share between the distributor and the exhibitor. So the deals work depending on what kind of movie, what kind of market it is. So yeah, so those are the main players. And the digital service providers are companies like Qube, who facilitate content readiness so that it's available for theatrical distribution. Right? Yeah. So when we talk about regional distributors, so one thing that we need to be really careful about is handling territorial rights. Say, for example, if I'm the production and I give rights to, say, one distributor for the US market. So that distributor in US market should be able to work out a deal with the exhibitors and play the content only in the US theaters, not anywhere else in the world, right? So those territorial permissions are something that are that need to be adhered. If they are not, then it becomes a legal issue. And in addition to the territory, again, it's the time window, how long the distributor can actually play the content. And likewise, between the distributor and the exhibitor, how long, you know, the exhibitor can actually play the content. So all these are basically encoded in the key that I was talking about. So when, as a production house, when I assign rights to a distributor, I give them what is called a DKDM, what is a distribution KDM, or in simple terms, you can just call it the distribution key. So that distributor will have rights only for that particular region and for the validity that I give. Usually it's about 1 or 2 months time when the production actually gives the rights for. And then the distributor then issues keys or KDMs to the theaters wherever the deal is actually signed. And that's usually for a shorter window as well. It's usually, depending on the movie, it could be for a week or it could be for a month. And then if the theater wants to extend the run because the movie is doing well, then they can always ask for another key and the distributor would send out another key. So, yeah. And what are the challenges, right? So one of the things is interesting things with right authorizations is, at least in South India, everything happens in the last minute. So if there's anyone who has experience of watching a 4 a.m. show for first day, first show, anybody? Yeah, so there might be cases where you would have seen, you know, a show scheduled, it's either delayed or canceled, right? It's all because the producer decides to, you know, give rights to the distributor at the last minute. And, you know, when we talk about last minute, it's really in a matter of 2 hours, you issue rights for about all the theaters in the world, which means you issue KDMs or keys for about 60,000 KDMs in 2 hours, right? So that's really the scale we're talking about. And then, So once all these are set, so the deals are all made in the market. And once these are done, then the logistics provider needs to enable all these contracts in, you know, however they're actually doing, and then make sure that the right content goes to the right theater and the right KDM is available for the right period of time based on the what the distributor and the production house has actually mentioned. So that's how distribution works. Just quickly move on to the next one. We have 15 minutes more. So as part of Qube Wire, that's the product distribution product which we have, we tried to solve some of these problems for that, right? So what are the main problems we solved? One, we reduce the time between production and exhibition. So when I say production and exhibition, right from the mastering, right? From that aspect, the once the content is mastered to the time the content is available in the theater. So before Qube Wire came into being, how did the content actually go out? It used to be hard drives that were physically shipped to the theaters. So think about it, you know, for a South Indian movie, the content is mastered mostly in Royapettah or Rangaro, right, where our offices are located. So once that is actually done, if you have to play a movie somewhere in South Africa or the US, you used to courier it from here. Think about the cost involved and the time involved. So if the air cargo is not available, then, you know, you're really dependent on third parties completely. So we've, as part of Qube Wire, we've reduced the time from, you know, from almost a week to, for Saho, we actually got the content ready, which is before mastering, right? Mastering got the input 48 hours before the movie actually released. And then in 48 hours, the content was made available and sent all over the world. And we're talking about three languages, Hindi, Tamil, and Telugu, right? And this wouldn't have been possible without, you know, a product like this. And in the next slide, Shiva will talk about how we'll enabled it. And we also enabled movie playback in remote areas, right? So where couriers are not available or, you know, earlier it was actually not possible. So digital cinema and Qube Wire is enabling all that.
Okay. So this has been mostly a silent crowd. So I want to make it a little bit interactive. I'm going to ask a couple of questions as I go through this. Please make it interactive. So Dhanya pointed out the different challenges and how we solved it. I'm going to talk about the technologies that we used in solving those problems. On a high level, I can categorize the challenges and the solution into some 3-4 categories, like the content transfer, reliability, security, and performance. So let me start with the transfer. So this is my first question. Let's say I'm sending you some content. You can consider this a HTTP form submit or whatever, to North Virginia on a 1 Gbps line. Can you guess what is the speed that I'll be able to upload the content from Chennai to North Virginia on a 1 Gbps internet pipe? Or let me provide additional information. So the round trip delay is 200 milliseconds. So yeah, I'll reveal the answer. It is, you hardly get 100 Mbps because of the round trip delay. So this problem or this phenomenon is called big fat pipe, they call it. So your pipe is really fat. I mean, it can accommodate a lot of data, but as TCP expects acknowledgement for each packet, it has to reach all the way to North Virginia, get the acknowledgement, then only it will send. So there are ways it already reduces the impact of it. There is a TCP window that you can configure, but there is only so much you can do. The solution to this is there are different ways. You can establish multiple connection and parallelly upload, but that might require a lot of socket buffer and you need to have a memory. So the approach that we used is a UDP-based upload mechanism. The exact protocol is called UDT. So it uses UDP packet to send the content, basically floods the destination with all the packets, but there is no guarantee that all the packets will reach the destination in the correct order. So that is where the UDT comes into play. It makes sure that it asks the sender to resend the packet for last packets, and it also readdress the packet. So with that, we are able to utilize the full bandwidth. If it is a 1 Gbps, we are able to utilize all the bandwidth. Doesn't matter where they are, whether they are uploading from North Virginia itself or India, the other part of the world. So that is on the upload part, and on the download, of course, the same problem exists in the download also. But there is a much bigger problem in the download, which is you have to send the content to thousands of theaters at the last minute. You probably get 12 hours time window. So how we are going to do that? You might wonder with today's cloud infrastructure, it just, I mean, I can just spawn these instances or do a CDN and deliver it. Of course, you can do that. But think about the file size, 300 GB, and the cost you would incur on the CDN. So we didn't want to do that. I mean, one is our entire the digital cinema distribution operates in a very low margin. So we cannot incur a lot of operation cost. We want to optimize that. So what we have done is we researched about it. We researched different protocol, different mechanism, the existing systems. We even tried experimenting something with the IPFS. How many of you know IPFS? The P2P hypermedia protocol. That is the distributed web. They're going to plan to use for the distributed web. So, but finally we settled on P2P technology. How many of you know BitTorrent? No, let me ask. So my next question is, how many of you use BitTorrent not for pirating? Okay, so yeah, we all know the P2P. I mean, when I say P2P, a lot of us are able to relate it to BitTorrent. That's a widely used protocol, not just for movie piracy, but also for distributing files, contents in a large recipient. So you can actually download your Ubuntu ISO. A lot of this always distro through BitTorrent. So we thought, I mean, when people use that technology for a bad deed, why don't we use it for a good deed? I mean, the same thing works for us as well. So we are using that, not in the same form. There are a lot of customization we have done, both at the implementation level and the protocol level. We brought in a security. In fact, today our distribution network, the distribution transfer work a little counterintuitive to the conventional performance knowledge. So we all experience when more people use it, system will slow down. But here actually in our distribution network, when it is a big movie, it really performs well because there are a lot of people downloading and the entire content need not be downloaded for it to share to other machine. As download happens at the individual 8 MB chunk level, the moment it receives 8 MB, it is free to share it to anyone. Within that, our P2P network. So that's how we are able to scale it to thousands of screens, and there is absolutely no limit to it because we are not paying for the cloud. So it is all the device and the theater network that is helping us to distribute the content. So that is about the transfer. Let me quickly jump to the various topic. Reliability. So. This being a large file, it is stored, it is transported to different medium. It is stored on a hard disk, then it is uploaded to our cloud system, then it is downloaded to the devices that we deployed in theaters so that it can be played in the theater screen. But throughout this workflow, the content can get corrupted at any point. So these are all unreliable medium. I mean, we can, the cloud, we know it is reliable, 99.99s. But what do you expect from a user machine? When you connect some random USB drive with the movie content, you cannot expect a high reliability. And so our system, the device that we deployed in theater, they have a software RAID, they are reliable, but still things can fail. The physical delivery, the hardest that we can send, we can guarantee that the content we wrote on the hard disk is correct, but we cannot guarantee that it will be the same when it reaches the destination. So we have put a lot of mechanism in this entire workflow to make sure the content integrity is maintained. For example, the software, desktop software, it's a cross-platform desktop software that we wrote for uploading the content that makes sure the content is fully, it is in a good condition. Before it uploads. So the digital cinema specification specifies that content hashes should be maintained along with the digital cinema. So that really helps us to make sure the content is in good condition or not. This happens at every level. So when before pushing it to the cloud, after receiving in the cloud, then from one S3 bucket to other S3 bucket, and after downloading it to the device machine, then after copying it to the destination hard disk. In fact, we even collect the hard drive smart information, which is a health status of the hard drive. We maintain it so that over the time we can proactively detect, hey, this is a 4-year hard disk, don't use this. It already, there are a lot of bad sector that we already found, so better use a different drive. So that is a level of monitoring or integrity check that we do to make sure the content reaches in a reliable manner. Then on the security, this is a big item. So we are talking about movies with a budget of 300 plus millions. So the last Avenger Infinity War is $300+ million dollars. And it got $500 million in first 5 days. So can you afford to make any mistake? I mean, can you lapse in security? Absolutely not. They will bring your company in a single file, a lawsuit. So security is an utmost priority. So the security for us, it's in two aspect. One is the content security. Even though content is fully encrypted, there are certain meta information that are maintained unencrypted, like how many cuts are there, and sometimes the subtitles are not encrypted because they would have been done by some third-party company in Middle East, and they might not be tech-savvy or they didn't have enough tool to encrypt it, so they simply upload it. So the but those part also we need to secure. So the objective in content delivery security is we should not 3 minutes. Okay, let me quickly wrap up. So we should not deliver the content, or the content should not be in the hand of unintended person. So how we do that is the entire communication is based on TLS. It is not HTTPS. It is TCP. TLS over a TCP. So how do we, I talked about P2P system and devices. These are all devices that are deployed in remote places, and we absolutely don't have any control over it. So how do we trust it? What if someone took over the possession of the device and they silently download all the content? So we have a short validity digital certificate that gets that expires in every 8 hours. And the moment we realize a certificate, a device is compromised, we mark it so that the certificate will not be generated and it cannot join our P2P network. So that is one aspect. And the key, we use hardware security modules where the key is never leaves the hardware. It is kept inside it. You can ask the hardware to encrypt something, decrypt something, sign it or verify it. And these are all devices used by US military, and they are certified by US military. In fact, one of the requirements to handle Hollywood content is your devices, either you should use certified devices, security modules like this, or your security module has to be certified. So we use one such a device where it is physically protected. There is an epoxy coating so that you cannot even sniff the electronic signal. And if you try to open it, it will tear the electronic component, it will self-destroy it. So that is a security measure we have. And Dhanya already spoke about the last minute rush, how content we receive the content at the last minute, and adding more salt to the wound. There are these legal cases that got settled at the last minute. We hardly have 2 hours. We have to send thousands and thousands of KDM for all the different versions of the content. And we rely on third-party system like email service that can go down. They are not designed for our load, right? So we have to design a system where it operates with multiple email delivery systems. So if one goes down, it will immediately route it to other one. So the objective is this. You guys should be able to watch the movie on the first day, first show. So that is our objective. Yeah.
So for I think most of you, a big release or a festival release is on the day, right? For us, the festival is the night before. So really, because that's when the KDMs are issued, and so we and actually some of our team is also here. So we all look forward to some of the challenges that happen. And yeah, the next one is Bigal. We're waiting for next week. So let's see. So one of the things is, so it's not like, so the aspects of security and the product itself was something that was built into the product right from the start. But say some of the challenges with respect to the scale and the performance is something we are that keeps evolving, right? So when we've launched it, it's not that we could generate all, you know, like 50,000 or 60,000 KDMs in 1 hour time. But today we can. How did we actually do that? With the lessons we learned with every single release, right? So initially when the product, and the one of the, just 2 more minutes, Ramki. So one of the, yeah. So one of the big satisfaction that, you know, working on such a product gives is that any big movie actually goes through your product, right? And we were lucky enough to launch out new features with every single big movie, right? So we also got free marketing, say for Kabali, Bahubali, and 2.0. All these movies, we actually launched new features. So the, you know, the production house anyway does the marketing, and they also say it was delivered through Qube Wire, which is a big plus for us. But also what that meant is we had a learning at every time, right? It's not that everything was without challenges. There were midnight oil burns because some key will not work somewhere. Or even if one screen doesn't get the KDM or it doesn't work, we need to figure out, you know, which server it is, why it didn't work, debug it and fix it so that the show is not interrupted. So now all the movies, all Indian movies releasing worldwide goes through Qube Wire, and this is familiar territory for us because the company has been there for a long time and it has actually been working. But we are expanding into new markets and the studios come on board. So I'm sure the challenge, there will be newer challenges, newer requirements, newer scalability issues, and we'll have to figure out ways to solve all of that.
Yeah. So do we have time for QA or we have to? One question.
And we'll still be around. So if there's any specific thing you want to talk about, and, we can talk about.
You can find our email ID. Please feel free to shoot any question you have.
Yeah, so we have competitors in the world. And so depending on the market, say for example, in the Europe market, there is another player who is more dominant than us. But if you, the way we are handling competition is one, looking at you know, what is needed for each market and building that into the product. One thing we've also realized while talking to most of you know, our customers is that Qube Wire is one of the solutions which is comprehensive. Because if you actually look at the competitor, each one offers a different delivery mode, like what Shiva spoke about, satellite delivery, right? So we offer multimodal delivery, like you know, internet, satellite, or hard drive. None of the other products actually do that. So if there is a specific requirement or a feedback coming from the customer saying, you know, this is a feature or, you know, this facility is there in the competitor and we really like that, then if it makes sense for the product roadmap and where we want to take the product, we quickly go ahead and build it into the product. So.
Thank you.